This is Software Engineering Radio, the podcast for professional developers on the web at se-radio.net. SE Radio is brought to you by the IEEE Computer Society and by IEEE Software Magazine, online at computer.org/software.
Hello, this is Matthew Farwell for Software Engineering Radio. Today's episode is about Kotlin with Dmitry Zhemerov and Svetlana Isakova. Dmitry was up until recently, the Kotlin Tools team lead at JetBrains and is co-author of Kotlin in Action. Svetlana is developer advocate at JetBrains and has been working on the Kotlin language since 2011. She is also one of the co-authors of Kotlin in Action. Welcome to Software Engineering Radio, Dmitry and Svetlana.
Hello. Hi, everyone.
Hi.
Today, we're going to talk about Kotlin, which is a language which runs on the Java Virtual Machine, the JVM. We've had plenty of SE Radio interviews before on the JVM and languages which run on it. For instance, episode 171, Scala Update with Martin Odersky. Episode 266, Charles Nutter on the JVM as a language platform. Episode 240, the Groovy language, Cédric Champeau. Episode 316, Nikolai Parlog on Java 9. Episode 158, Rich Hickey on Clojure. And this isn't even mentioning the other projects that run on the JVM that we've had interviews on before, such as Spring, Kafka, Akka. So all of this brings us neatly onto the first question. With so many already existing languages on the JVM, why another one?
Well, when we started Kotlin, we found ourselves in a position that we were building development tools for many other languages, both JVM languages like Java and Scala and non-JVM languages like Python and Ruby. And we found that none of the existing languages really seemed like a good fit for us, because we absolutely required static typing, so Groovy was not an option. We required just something manageable and not overly complex, so we were not really excited about the idea of moving to Scala. And some other options like Clon simply did not exist at this point. So we decided that, okay, so if we see this problem for us, then probably we are not the only company in the world that is in the same situation. So why don't we go and try solve it? So that's how basically we started with Kotlin.
And I just want to add that we really wanted a language that can be easily interoperable with Java, easily mixed with Java. And it seems that we reached this goal, more or less. Fine, so we're quite happy about that.
Yeah, and one more thing to add is that even though Kotlin started its life as a JVM-only language, we have since that time moved quite far beyond that. So Kotlin has a JavaScript backend, allowing you to run Kotlin code in your browser. And we are also working on Kotlin Native, which is a compiler of Kotlin to just native code that can run on embedded machines, that can run on iOS, it can run on like basically anywhere where the JVM is not available.
Okay, so if we talk about paradigms, we have Clojure, which is a Lisp-like language. Groovy is a dynamic language. Scala tries to mix object-oriented and functional paradigms. JRuby is, well, it's Ruby, it's a dynamic language. What is the philosophy behind Kotlin? What is Kotlin's paradigm?
Pragmatic language for developers.
Yeah, so Kotlin is indeed pragmatic. And so in terms of like the basics, it's statically typed and it mixes the object-oriented and functional metaphors. Compared to Scala, it has less of an impact on functional programming. It does not intentionally support some of the like advanced functional programming concepts such as higher-kinded types. And other than that, well, I think its mix of object-oriented and functional techniques is fairly commonplace in today's programming language landscape.
Why was Kotlin created? Was it just purely so that you could develop IntelliJ in it?
Of course not. So even though we start our products based on like seeing our own unmet needs, our needs are not unique. And of course, we did not start Kotlin just for internal use. We wanted to build a language that would be useful for other companies, for the community as well.
So what do you have any stated goals for Kotlin?
Just make developers' lives better. So basically as simple as that. Like the motto of our company has been, until our latest rebranding, it was develop with pleasure. And I think it's like what has been driving the design of Kotlin as well. So just making it more pleasant to develop software for people who are like-minded, who think like we do.
Okay. So what are the target use cases for Kotlin?
Basically, our aim is to fill all the niches where Java is currently being used. So anything that you are writing in Java nowadays, you can do with Kotlin, just with less code and more productivity and simply more in a more enjoyable way.
To replace Java everywhere.
So it literally is that. It's a Java replacement idea.
It was where we started. And now with our current set of target platforms, our main goal has shifted a little bit. So we just don't just want to replace Java. We want to let you use the same code to develop all tiers of your modern applications. So if you are building an app with a backend, a browser frontend, and mobile clients for iOS and Android, we want to enable you to use Kotlin to build all the parts of your application.
Okay, so the use cases are, for instance, server-side code, JavaScript replacement?
JavaScript replacement not by itself. So, I mean, if you have a pure JavaScript project and you want to become more productive and like enjoy more static typing, then there are other languages such as TypeScript which may be a better fit for you. They just integrate more tightly with the JavaScript ecosystem, they interoperate better with JavaScript libraries, and so on. What Kotlin gives you, which TypeScript does not exactly give you, is the possibility to reuse your code between all parts of your application, backend, web frontend, and Android and iOS.
Okay, so if we can drill down, let's start at the beginning. Let's start at the basics. How does the syntax in Kotlin work? Is it compatible with Java syntax like Groovy is, or is it a completely different syntax like Clojure or Scala?
It reminds very much a Groovy or Scala. If you have experience with these languages, when you look at Kotlin, you will find very many similarities with that. And so it's concise, it's less broad than Java. Actually, I think we did the same job that other more modern languages like Scala or Groovy did at their time, with providing a better, more concise syntax.
So somebody coming along to the Kotlin code who's familiar with Java code would be able to read it.
Yeah, sure.
But it's not compatible in the way that Groovy is. So you cannot simply copy a Java file, rename a Java file to Kotlin and just have it compile. What you can do instead is you can use our converter. So we have built a tool that automatically converts Java code to Kotlin. So you can use it to migrate your code. You can use it to like look up some syntax details that you are not yet familiar with as you're learning the language.
Okay, could you give me some examples of where it differs?
We have the very classical example, those data classes, I think. Every language uses this example in all the special introduction to Kotlin presentations. They use this example. When you have a class and in Java, you have to declare all the fields, getters, and setters, and the constructor, and in Kotlin, it's just one line that generates all the methods for you. And some of the other useful methods, such as hashcode or equals as well.
Okay, so this is similar to the case classes in Scala.
Yes. If you start to compare them, you'll find lots of similarities at the very beginning level. Not going deeper into details, but just into introduction level, there are very many similar concepts and things.
Okay, so let's drill down on the data classes. What does that give you?
Just basically, it removes boilerplate that is often required to fulfill some of the common tasks. And it's actually so useful that Java right now is considering to add a very similar feature. I think the current term that Java uses is records. And I think it may be on the roadmap for Java 11, maybe. I'm not exactly sure. But
okay.
Or 11 or 12. But they are working on a design for a very similar feature.
I love it that they've chosen a completely different name. There you go. They haven't gone with case classes or data classes. They've gone with records, but never mind. So coming on to classes and interfaces, what are the differences between Java's classes and interfaces and Kotlin's classes and interfaces? Could you give me an example of some of the differences? Something extra that you can do in Kotlin that you can't do in Java?
So basically, probably the most major difference is that in Kotlin, you don't have fields. Instead, you have properties which essentially abstract the difference between a field and essentially a getter and setter method. So when you declare a property, it is compiled into a field if one is required, and it's compiled into a pair of getter setter methods. And this essentially gives you a more concise syntax to do the same thing that you usually do in Java with a bunch of boilerplate. Other than that, because Kotlin is interoperable with Java, its class and interface model is also very similar to Java. So it also has overloads, it also has So every class has one base class and can implement multiple interfaces. So there is not that much, not that many differences in that level.
Can you do default implementations in interfaces like you can in Java?
Yeah, you can do it in Kotlin.
So which versions of Java do you support?
So we support, the minimum support is Java. It's Java 6. So yes, we do support default methods on Java 6. They are not interoperable with Java 8's default methods in that case, so they implement it slightly differently. So the feature works on all JVM levels, starting with Java 6.
Could you just explain quickly what a default method is on an interface?
So default method is basically a method that you, inside the interface, you can define some method bodies. And if you don't implement those methods in the derived classes, then those method bodies will be used as an implementation.
Okay, so this isn't the default behavior in Java by default. You can't do this in Java up until Java 8, as I remember.
Right.
Okay, so before that, how does Kotlin work with default implementations?
We basically just, the compiler copies those methods into the class file, if you put it simple. There's the actual implementation is a bit more complicated, but it's a bit difficult to explain it just without being able to show code. So, yeah.
Okay. Is there an inheritance tree like there is in Scala, where if you implement multiple interfaces with default implementations, it chooses the last one?
No, in Kotlin, you specifically have to say which implementation you want to choose.
Okay, so you have to actually code it yourself.
Yes, that's one of the things where Scala probably sometimes goes too implicit. Like the thing that you have to understand how it works. And in Kotlin, knowing such cases from other languages, from experience of other language designers, we decided to go with the more explicit ways. For instance, here, if you have several inherited implementations, you explicitly have to say which one you want to choose here, or probably all of them. But again, you just write it explicitly.
And you can do that by implementing it yourself and then calling the particular one that you're after.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. Classes are final by default in Kotlin?
Yes, right.
Could you explain why?
So this is something that we have given a lot of consideration to, but basically our idea was that we want to follow the guidelines of books like Effective Java, which says that basically you have to either design for inheritance or prohibit it. So if you just let people extend your class, then they may end up breaking all sorts of implicit contracts in your code that you may not expect people to break. Another thing which is more important in the case of Kotlin is that Kotlin has this feature called Smartcasts. Smartcast basically allows you to get rid of this Java pattern where you have to first check the type and then cast the variable to the type that you have just checked. So in Kotlin, if you, for example, if you check that the local variable is an instance of a specific type, then you can later use it as if it was cast to this type, even though the cast is not explicitly there in the code. You can also do this with properties of classes, but only if the compiler knows that the property is immutable. So if it cannot be changed between the time you checked it and between the time you use the value again. And if classes were open by default, then all properties would also be open by default, and you would not be able to use smartcast on properties because the compiler would not be able to know that no one else is extending this class and modifying the behavior of this property.
So does Kotlin push you towards an immutable style of programming?
Yes, we kind of try to do this. We are not dogmatic about this. You can use all the tools for working with mutable state as well. But there are some features that that go in favor of immutability. For example, Kotlin separates read-only and mutable interfaces for collections, so that even though it uses the standard Java collection classes, it exposes two different APIs for each of the classes like list and set and map. One is read-only and the other is mutable, and you can make it explicit that you are not going to mutate the collection in a specific place if you just use the read-only interface to access it.
That's interesting. Does that could I then cast that into a mutable version and then just modify it? And
you can if you want to, but you realize that you are doing something hacky, and this is
okay.
Just a way to deceive the maintainers of your code.
Okay. Well, you can do everything with reflection anyway, can't you? So
True.
Okay. Everything is an expression in Kotlin. Could you explain why you chose that way of doing things?
Well, it just lets us do... not everything is an expression in Kotlin. So, for example, an assignment is not an expression in Kotlin. So, like in Java, where you can put an assignment in the middle of some statement, we find it confusing, so we don't really allow it. But things like if and if and try and when, which is the Kotlin equivalent of switch, they are expressions, and it just allows you to write code more concisely in many cases, where you can just immediately return one of multiple values from a function just by using the when expression as essentially the body of the function directly.
So does this mean that you don't need the ternary operator, for instance?
Well, people still want to have the ternary operator in Kotlin, but yes, you can do without it.
Okay.
People still want it, and maybe it will be added at some point. It has been quite controversial.
People still want it and complain that they don't have it, but we usually tell them, you have if, so don't worry.
Yes. Well, I think the ternary operator is one of the few functional things that you find in Java, because it is a functional operator. You mentioned when. Could you explain when?
So it's basically Kotlin's equivalent to the switch operator. So the difference is that it's not restricted to like comparing a value to a set of constants, which is what switch does in Java. So inside a when expression, you can essentially perform arbitrary checks. You can check for types. You can check for whether a value belongs to a range, and so on. So it's just more flexible than Java switch.
So is this equivalent to the pattern matching in Scala?
Not exactly. So Scala's pattern matching is a little bit more powerful, because it also can assign. You can very easily take an entire object tree and essentially unpack it and assign names to various components of that tree. Kotlin's when expressions compared with SmartCast can do some of that, but they don't work with nested expressions, so it's like a little bit more limited. But in practice, we find that it covers most of the same use cases.
So is this another example of, okay, so you were looking at Scala, you found it was a bit too complicated, so you took the simple idea of pattern matching and then you applied that and simplified it down, and you got 90% of the way there without the extra 10% of the complexity?
Yeah, you can say that.
Okay. And checked exceptions.
So yeah, we do not have checked exceptions in Kotlin. And the reason for that is that just in our experience, maybe it's just checked exception. Maybe it's the problem is not with checked exceptions, but rather with the way they are being used in all the Java ecosystem. But they don't really work in our opinion. So first of all, they are just which exceptions are checked and which exceptions are not checked is just sometimes not very easy to explain. For example, if you close a socket or if you close a file, this can throw a checked exception, and you have to handle this exception in some way, even though there is no meaningful way for you to handle the failure of this operation. But on the other hand, if you try to parse a number, parse a string to a number, and the string you have passed is not actually a number, then you get an unchecked exception. The compiler does not tell you that you have to handle this case when it's not a number, even though it's actually very common, much more common than a problem with closing a socket. And in a lot of enterprise-style Java code that I have seen, like there is lots and lots and lots of lines dedicated to handling and logging and rethrowing exceptions. And this does not actually give you any extra level of safety, just a lot of boilerplate just dealing with cases which cannot really be handled really well, but you still have to do something about them. So you wrap exception and rethrow exceptions and log exception, and it's just crazy.
Or add it to the list of checked exceptions which are on the command on the function that apply to the function.
You don't always have the ability to do that, but yes, sometimes you do that.
Okay, so let's drill down a little bit on the types. You said that Kotlin was a statically typed language, which is similar to Java and Scala. So what differences are there between Java's type system and Kotlin's type system?
So for the type system, there is one big difference, namely that Kotlin has explicit support in the type system for nullability. So for every type, basically, you have to say whether these values of this type can be null or not. And if you allow them to be null, then you cannot perform operations such as calling methods on them without checking for null. And so this measure allows you to get rid of a very large percentage of null pointer exceptions at runtime. And at the same time, it helps get rid of a lot of like this defensive style of Java programming, like in enterprise Java code. You usually don't have, you don't only have a lot of code dealing with exceptions, you also have lots and lots and lots of null checks, because you just don't know which values can be null. So just to be safe, you check all of them for null. And this is just bloats the code immensely. And in Kotlin, you can have the same level of safety because the compiler can just make sure that this value is never null, so you don't have to check it. And if it can be null, then you have tools to deal with that, such as safe calls and Elvis operator and so on.
Okay, so let's drill down a little bit. How do I declare something as nullable or not nullable?
So you declare something nullable, but just by putting a question mark after the type. So if you just a string is never null, and string question mark is either string or null.
So are things nullable? So again, it's pushing you into the direction of declaring things which are not nullable by default, because you don't have the question mark on by default.
Right.
What's the difference between that and the nullable annotation in Java, or the not nullable and not null annotation in Java?
The difference is that it's enforced. So in Java, like, you can put the nullable and not null annotations in some places in the code, and it's actually gets very tedious. So we use nullable and not null annotations in IntelliJ quite a lot, and like during code reviews, people still have to remind each other all the time, like, why don't you add some nullability annotations? And even if you add them all over the place, and then if you try to call a method on something which is nullable, it's just a warning. You can still compile the code and you can still end up with an error at runtime. And in Kotlin, this is enforced, so you have to specify nullability everywhere.
I want to add that if you put your nullable annotations on the Java code, in Kotlin, these types are visible as nullable and not nullable types. And this is one of the first advices that we give to people who start adding Kotlin to their Java projects. Just try to annotate your code if it's not already annotated, so that Kotlin type system was considering these Java types as correct nullable and not nullable types.
So you're saying that the Kotlin compiler reads the at nullable annotation and treats it as if it was a question mark on the end of the type?
Yeah.
Okay. So if I was planning to migrate to Kotlin, that would be a good step in the right direction.
Yep. To add these annotations to your existing Java code.
Okay. So could you give me an example of where a nullable type would have caught and or prevented a bug?
So I don't know, just there are so many places where you just have to remember to check for things, and I don't have any specific example on my mind.
An example when you dereference something, otherwise you'll get null pointer exception. And with nullable types, Kotlin enforces you to check it. And what's more important, what is the difference? Why? Like, some people may say, okay, we can have the same annotations in Java. Why we just don't put them on Java code and that's it? The answer is that in Java, when you have this annotation, you still have to explicitly check every time for like whether it's null or not. Put a lot of verbosity in the code, like saying if something is not null, return. For instance, if something is not null, do something else. And in Kotlin, we have a lot of very useful, by the way, the same operations as in Groovy language, like Elvis operation and suffixes operators, and they allow us to express these checks in a much more concise way. So that's the main difference.
Are you saying that you could reduce the number of tests that you would have to write, for instance, for a particular function because you knew it wasn't nullable?
Well, if you talk about tests, I'm personally not a fan of just writing those lots and lots of unit tests which check all the possible like inputs and outputs and states. And I just don't find this to be very valuable, because a lot of tests, you just write them, then they never fail because they test for errors that are so trivial that you don't make them, and then you change the implementation of the function and you have to rewrite all the tests, and this is just tedious and does not bring any value. So if you talk about testing, like I'm personally in the school that favors functional level testing more than unit level testing.
A property-based testing, do you mean?
No, I don't mean well, you can use property-based testing if that is applicable to your situation, but I mean, in IntelliJ or in Kotlin, most tests that we write are just like high-level functional tests. So if you compile this piece of code and run it, then it has to produce this result. And if you run this refactoring on this piece of code, then this result has to look like that. And the huge advantage of these tests is that they do not depend on implementation in any way. So you can just write them, and whatever you do with implementation, they just keep helping you, and they just keep detecting regressions if you make a mistake when you change the implementation. But this is just an aside. This is not directly about Kotlin, so yeah.
Yeah, I think it's about the general comparison between dynamic type languages and statical type languages. And in dynamical type languages, you have to test for every trivial input, output, for lots of trivial things. And static type languages allow to check it by the compiler.
Okay.
So, and Kotlin gives even more power than Java because it allows us to check for more types of errors, for instance, including this null pointer exception as well.
Are nullable types enforced at runtime, or is it just at compile time?
There are runtime checks. I should say that not null types are enforced, because nullable types are just there. You just don't need to enforce them. For public APIs, Kotlin does generate runtime checks that make sure that, for example, if you're calling Kotlin methods from Java, then basically at the boundary of Kotlin and Java code, we verify that correct values are being passed in.
Okay, so what happens when if you pass a null in?
You just get an exception which states exactly like this parameter has to be not null, but you passed a null. So it's much easier to investigate than a null pointer exception some random place in the code after the value has been stored into a data structure and then accessed in it much, much later.
So if I am calling Kotlin code from Java and I'm expecting a not null, then you will get this exception. You will get this check. But I don't get that check if I'm calling it from Kotlin?
No, it's not exactly like that. So the checks are also there when Kotlin code calls another Kotlin method, a public Kotlin method, because it's just not feasible to compile the code in such a way that the checks would be skipped. But for private methods, we don't generate any checks because we don't expect private methods to be called from non-Kotlin code. So we just assume that the nullability is correct. Of course, you can call them via reflection, but you can break everything if using reflection, and that's just one of the minus things that you can break.
And how is a nullable type represented in Java?
It's just the same type. It has the nullable annotation on it, but otherwise it's just the same type.
Okay.
There is confusion to mix the concept of nullable types with the concept of option or optional types used in Java 8 or Scala. And I wanted to clarify that these are different concepts that solve the same goal, the same task. However, optional and option types are wrappers, a special wrappers that is either a wrapper over a value or a special value none. Now, while the nullable types, they are represented by just annotations at the compile time, and at the runtime, they are just objects stored. So there is no wrapper. All the checks exist only on the compile time and via the additional checks that Dmitry was talking about.
Okay, so how does it work the other way around then? If I'm calling Java code from Kotlin and the Java code returns a string, does that actually return a nullable string? Is that represented in Kotlin as a nullable string?
It depends on whether you have an annotation on your Java code that the moment we started to discuss about that when you introduce the Kotlin, then it's a good idea to annotate your code. If it's not annotated, it's represented as a special, I don't know what is it, type, and it behaves like in Java, so you still can have your null pointer exceptions. But we usually provide a lot of like explanation on how that works. Everyone can find them and dig more deeper if interested.
What type do you get if it doesn't have an annotation on it?
So the term for it is platform type.
Okay.
And basically, it's basically a type for which we do not have nullability information. So we do not force you to check for null when you use these values, but we also do not provide any guarantees. And in early versions of Kotlin, we tried to consider to treat these types as always nullable unless you had annotations. And it turns out that Kotlin code becomes just much, much harder to write because it's all full of null checks, which don't bring any value because the values cannot actually be null. So we just let you treat those values as you see fit. So if you know that you need to check for null, you just check it. And if you don't, then you just use the values directly.
How do I express a platform type in Kotlin, and I don't understand how that works?
You don't express a platform type in Kotlin directly, so they only come up when there's an interoperability scenario.
With Java?
Yeah, with Java, you can see them in error messages. Sometimes they are types that follow by exclamation marks, but you cannot use this in the code. It's not a syntax. It's just an annotation for that means this type came from Java.
Okay, and can I transform a platform type into a Kotlin type?
Yeah, surely. And you can just assign to a value of nullable or not nullable type. And then it's a good advice if you do not don't have an option to annotate your code, then it's a good idea to specify your types explicitly, because in Kotlin you can either provide the type annotation or omit it, as in languages like Scala or Groovy. And in this case, it makes sense to specify the type explicitly so that the compiler enforces additional checks. So for instance, if you try to assign a result of a method of a Java method to non-nullable type in Kotlin, an additional check is generated, and if you try to assign null, you will get a runtime exception saying that, okay, this is incorrect, you cannot do this.
Okay, so just one quick question. Do you have any extra information which is stored in the class file? So, for instance, when you're generating a Scala class, there's extra information which is stored in the class file to do with the types and other interesting things. Is the same true of Kotlin, or do you just base yourself on the nullable types, on the nullable annotation?
It is true of Kotlin, so we generate a special annotation called addMetadata, which essentially contains a base64 serialized a protocol buffer representation of the metadata that Kotlin knows about the classes, the class and its methods.
Okay, so if I were to want to try to interact with Kotlin at a level which is not going through the Kotlin compiler, then I would need to understand that. The same as with Scala.
Yes, we provide a library that can parse this metadata, cool. So you can use it if you want to.
How does Kotlin handle variance and covariance? Could you explain a bit more about covariance, for instance, and explain how Kotlin handles it?
Basically, the concepts of covariance and contravariance describe, they apply to generic types. They explain how the subtyping relationship between the types is related to the subtyping relationship with between the type parameters. So this was really probably very confusing, so I'll give an example. So, for example, if you have a list of something, for example, a list of animals and a list of cats, our covariance describes whether the list of cats is a subtype of list of animals when the cat is a subtype of animal. And if the list is read-only, then a list of cats is indeed a subtype of a list of animals, because all the operations that you perform on the list of animals are also valid when applied to a list of cats, because you are just taking values out of the list and, like, when you're getting values of the subtype, it's just as correct. In Kotlin, we have something called declaration site variance, which is a bit different from Java. So in Java, by default, types are invariant. And if you want to use a type in a covariant or contravariant way, you have to annotate a specific use of the types. For example, when you then write lists, for example, list question mark extends t. This marks this particular list as a covariant. In Kotlin, we specify in the declaration of the class that a list is all like a read-only list is always covariant. So you don't have to repeat the variance annotations every time you use the class. But other than that, the concept works quite similar to what Java has.
When you say you have a read-only version of the list, an immutable version of the list, and an immutable.
No, we don't have the word immutable at all in Kotlin. We try to avoid it as much as possible, and we try to say, no, we have read-only views on collections on interfaces, of collection interfaces, but we so far do not provide immutable versions of these collections, immutable data structures in their definition.
If I'm looking at some Kotlin code, I see list string. How do I know that that is the read-only version?
It's just we have two interfaces. One is list, and the other one is called mutable list. So when you see list, it's just read-only collection. But it's important that it's just read-only interface. It's just interface that lacks all the mutating method. But under the hood, you can have still your regular array list, Java util array list.
Okay, so it's literally two different interfaces. You've introduced this immutable list or immutable set or immutable hash immutable map,
read-only set, read-only list, and read-only map. Yeah, and they just lack this mutable prefix, and they lack all the mutating methods. And in the future, we have some plans to provide also mutable versions of collections, truly mutable versions of collections. But so far, we have only mutable implementations, standard Java ones, in fact.
So let's move on to functions and higher order functions and lambdas. How do functions and higher order functions differ from the Java versions?
So in terms of regular functions, there are some differences. For example, we have we support top-level functions, so you don't have to put your functions inside a class. We support something called extension functions, which is a very powerful way to like pretend that you are extending the API of a different over another class without actually modifying its source code. So you can define an extension function which looks like a method on a class such as string, but in fact it's just a static method that receives a string as a parameter and does not get any access to the private part of the string.
So is this similar to the implicit functions, implicit conversions?
It's somewhat similar to the implicit conversions, but the difference with Scala is that, as far as I understand, you actually get an instance of this implicit class. So this implicit conversion gives you an actual instance of the new class that you're implicitly converting to. And then the methods are being invoked on that instance. So there is actual overhead at runtime for performing this conversion. And with extension functions, there is no runtime overhead. It's just a static method that is called using a slightly different syntax.
So if I understand correctly, that's more like the C# model than the Scala model.
Exactly. This is very similar to C# extension functions.
Okay. Are functions pure in Kotlin?
No, they aren't. And there's no way to check whether a function is pure. Maybe this will be at some point, but right now it's not.
And do we have the possibility to have function values like in Java or Scala?
Yeah, sure. We have higher order functions, so you can store essentially functions as variables. You can pass them to as parameters, or you can return them from functions.
You say in Kotlin in Action that Kotlin is good for DSL construction. Could you say why Kotlin is good for DSL construction? Actually, maybe it's better a good idea to explain what a DSL is first.
Yeah, so basically DSL is something called a domain-specific language. And the idea, the original idea of DSLs was that you can have languages which completely different syntax, which exist outside of your main program just to perform specific tasks, like, for example, text matching, for which you have regular expression language, or database queries for which you have SQL. And those are called external DSLs. But external DSLs are quite cumbersome to develop because you have to build your own parser and sometimes a compiler as well, and you have to somehow integrate them into your main development workflow, and this is just a lot of effort. And internal DSLs are just a way of writing code in the main language that you are using, which minimizes the amount of syntactic overhead and also maximizes structure. So that if it's a language, then it has to have certain structure and grammar. DSLs essentially let you structure your code in a way that's more complicated than just a sequence of method calls.
Okay, so why would I want to do that?
This is just more concise and easier to read in many cases because it just you remove syntactic boilerplate and have code that is just looks more like the more close to the specification of the task that you want to perform, and less like a set of instructions that you need to perform that task.
Okay, so in Groovy or, for instance, Scala, you can remove some of the boilerplate. So there is a DSL for HTML construction in Groovy, which you open a brace, you do TR, open a brace, and then you put the TDs in the inside the brace. Is it very similar to Kotlin?
It is something very, very similar to Kotlin, but with all the difference, in Kotlin you have types.
Okay.
Yeah, so we are actually Groovy was the main inspiration for the DSL support that we have in Kotlin, and we support very similar syntax. We also have a DSL for writing HTML, which looks almost exactly like Groovy. Yeah, and the main difference is that it's completely statically typed.
Okay. Was the writing of DSLs one of the goals of design goals of Kotlin?
Yes, you can say that.
Okay.
So, for example, if you look at Gradle, so Gradle has picked up Kotlin as a second language in which you can write build scripts, specifically because Kotlin has been focusing on writing DSLs from the very beginning, and because when they used Kotlin as a DSL, they get all the support from the IDE, like in terms of code completion and navigation and syntax checking. This just comes for free because Kotlin is a statically typed language.
Which version of Gradle is that going to go into?
I think they are already shipping that.
Okay.
I don't think it's formally called 1.0 yet, but they are shipping. They have been shipping Kotlin DSL for quite some time as part of the core Gradle distribution.
Okay, so that's actually part of the core. So people, that's a way that people could try out Kotlin.
Yes.
For instance, without really impacting their processes. Okay. And Kotlin is an official language for Android development. What are the advantages of using Kotlin over Java with respect to Android? Are there any particular things, or is it just the normal types?
I don't think there is anything specific. So it's just more concise. It's just like more readable, like stuff like lambdas that it provides. It's just a lot of stuff that Kotlin provides finds a lot of use in the Android world. And also, since Google is investing into Android heavily, they are providing a set of wrappers around Android APIs, which is called Android KTX. And basically, this is a library that wraps the Android APIs into a Kotlin-friendly way. And with using these APIs, you can access the Android framework in a much more concise way with less code and just more easily. And this is entirely enabled by the language features that Kotlin brings that Java does not have, such as extension methods and lambdas with the receiver and stuff like that.
Okay, so this is, again, one of the main use cases for Kotlin, is that you can do that in Kotlin and use the lambdas. You don't have to stick to the older Java versions. Okay, so let's talk about the ecosystem. JetBrains evidently is behind Kotlin. Does that mean it's only available in IntelliJ? What about other IDEs such as Eclipse or even Emacs?
So as for other IDEs, we are sponsoring the development of the Eclipse plugin. So we have been doing it internally for some time. Then it was put on hiatus for like various reasons. And now we are contracting an outside company to help us with the development. There used to be a plugin for NetBeans. We are no longer maintaining it because we just don't see enough adoption. For like plain text editors such as Emacs, we do not officially support anything, but there are community developed like syntax highlighting modes for, I think, all major editors.
But obviously the thrust is behind IntelliJ.
Yes, but all, like Kotlin is not coupled to IntelliJ in any way. You can do everything from the command line if you want to.
Okay. And what about build tools? Are there Gradle, Maven, Ant, SBT plugins?
Yeah, so we support, JetBrains supports Maven, Gradle, and Ant. There is a specific new build system written entirely in Kotlin, which is called Cobalt, which is built by someone from the Kotlin community, and which is also a nice alternative to the above three. There is, I think Google invests into support for Kotlin in Bazel, which is Google's in-house build system that they open source at some point. I think I've seen mentions of Kotlin SBT plugin at some point, but I'm not sure if it exists.
Are Google using Kotlin internally?
They are starting to use it, yes. Google has a very advanced internal tool chain that all the languages need to integrate with, and they are right now working on building this integration. So I guess at this time, the adoption of Kotlin inside Google is still limited, but they really want to grow it.
Okay, as a replacement for Java. And what are there any libraries which are written in pure Kotlin?
Yeah, quite a few of them. So for example, there is, at JetBrains, we have this web framework built in Kotlin, which is called Kator. And this is just started basically an experiment, what can we accomplish if we want to start building a web framework using all the native tools that Kotlin provides, such as DSLs and coroutines and all of the other goodies. And it turned out to be a quite usable and very, very, very fast web framework. So we are quite happy with the results so far. And also there are community-developed libraries. For example, there is something called Aero.kt, which is a community-developed library that adds a lot of functional programming primitives to Kotlin, which are not available in the standard library.
I'd like to bring you back to something you just mentioned, coroutines. Could you explain more about what coroutines are and how you use them in Kotlin?
So to put it simple, a coroutine is a computation that can be suspended and later resumed. So this is the most general definition for that. And what you can do with coroutines, essentially, you can do some, other languages have this primitive called async await, And Kotlin's coroutines are essentially a generalization of that. So basically, instead of, like, if you imagine a web server application, it has to execute for handle a lot of clients, and it has also to wait for a whole lot of things. So it has to, if it sends a database query, it has to wait for the query to complete. If it sends a web request to another web service, it has to wait for the response to come back. And basically, there are multiple ways that you can do this waiting. So one way is that you can use threads. So basically, you run a thread for each request that you are processing, and every time you need to wait for something, you just pause the thread and wait for the thread to resume when the thing you are waiting for comes back. And this is nice, and this is a fairly simple programming paradigm, but the problem with that is, like, threads have a fairly large overhead. So every thread requires quite a lot of memory for the stack and for other bookkeeping stuff, and so the number of threads you can realistically have on a JVM is fairly limited. And with coroutines, the approach is different. So you, instead of, like, having these threads at pause, you just have a few threads, as many as you have CPU cores, and you have a dispatcher that basically takes care of the waiting. So it suspends the coroutine when it has something to wait for, and it gives the execution to another coroutine. And so in this way, you have much less overhead, and you can have many more coroutines running on parallel. So on a regular laptop, you could have a million coroutines running in parallel very easily.
Okay, and so that's similar to the async await, you said?
Yes, exactly.
So that would be async await in, I think it's in C#, in F#, in Scala, in Java now?
No, Java does not have any. So there is something called Project Loom, which is going to bring a variation of this approach to Java, but it's still early in development, and it has significant conceptual differences to what we do in Kotlin with coroutines.
So again, this is a shim on top of the JVM. So this is something you developed yourself. This is a library that you've developed yourself.
It's not as much a library. First of all, it's a compiler feature.
Okay.
So if you have a method, it transforms this method into a special form, which allows you to basically resume the execution of a method from the middle, from some point in the middle. So if you just do an await inside the method, then we just stop the execution of the method at some point. And when the thing that you are awaiting for comes back, we just jump into the middle of the method and resume execution from that point after the await. And this is very similar to what C# does. So basically, our approach has lots and lots of similarities to what C# does.
Okay. When I'm developing a library in Scala, and I want that to be usable from Java, I have to provide Java interface so it looks sensible from Java. Is that a good idea in Kotlin, or do I not need to do that at all?
You usually don't need to do that. So there are special annotations that let you control the shape of the Java API that is produced from specific Kotlin code. So, for example, Kotlin does not have static methods, but using annotation, you can expose certain methods as Java static methods. Or you can expose fields directly. As I mentioned, Kotlin has properties, but if you want to have fields in your Java API, you can have them. So basically, you don't have to build a separate interface. You just need to put some annotations on your main Kotlin interface. And this is much less work, obviously.
Yeah, and I can just add that that works this way because that was one of the goals. So at the very beginning, when Scala was considered as an option as a language that can be used to develop IntelliJ, for instance, one of the biggest problems with this was interoperability. So with Scala, you have to do special tricks when you really want to mix two languages. And in my opinion, Scala fits better if you just write the whole application, the whole thing in Scala. And in Kotlin, you have this option to mix two languages, and it works because a lot of design decisions were made to make it work.
Okay. Are there any static analysis tools specific to Kotlin? So for instance, I'm thinking about findbugs or PMD or checkstyle.
So first of all, IntelliJ has a very large set of inspections that analyze Kotlin code. The most essential tools are what you get in the box, out of the box with IntelliJ. And you can also run them from the command line, and we are also working on a Gradle plugin that lets you run them as part of a Gradle build. In addition to that, there are a couple of third-party tools that do static checks for Kotlin, but I don't think they are as advanced as the inspections that we have in IntelliJ.
Can you use checkstyle?
No, checkstyle works specifically on Java source code, so no, it does not work with Kotlin in any way. You can use findbugs because findbugs analyzes bytecode, and Kotlin produces bytecode that findbugs understands. You will get some extra complaints that you just cannot do anything about, but you will also get actual real useful reports from findbugs.
So if we move on to the last section, which is how does Kotlin help me in producing secure code?
I don't think there are any advantages in that regard, just other than general safety benefits of Kotlin. So like null pointer exceptions are potentially dangerous because like sometimes they can lead to, like in some situations they can lead to like denial of service attacks, for example, or data leakage, and like in some very specific situations, and Kotlin just prevents them. But other than that, the security model of Kotlin is very similar to Java, and basically the set of threats and benefits is essentially the same. And you can, for example, take the Java secure coding guidelines, and almost all of them apply to Kotlin as is, as written.
Okay, so I can, if I know how to write secure code in Java, then I can write secure code in Kotlin.
Yes, exactly.
Okay. Is Kotlin open source?
Yes, it is.
Okay, so imagine that I submitted a PR. Would it get accepted?
It depends.
Yeah, this really depends. So if you want to actually change the language, then a pull request is not a very good point to start. So you actually start with submitting a design proposal. So we have a process called KEEP, like Kotlin Evolution and something process. I don't remember the exact.
Probably.
Yeah, Kotlin Evolution and Enhancement, exactly. And you can submit a proposal for a language feature, and then then we discuss it internally with the team. And if the feature gets accepted, then you can actually proceed to the implementation. And then you can submit a PR for the implementation. What is much easier is submitting a pull request to the tools. So actually, most of the contributors, we have quite a few external contributors helping us with the development of Kotlin, and most of them actually help us with the IntelliJ plugin, because it's much easier to contribute something to the IntelliJ plugin. It does not have to go through design. There are no backwards compatibility concerns.
Okay.
And it's just much easier.
I would imagine it's the same thing with the Gradle plugins or Ant or Maven.
Yes. It's, well, the Gradle plugin has its DSL, which also needs to be like backwards compatible. So there's also there's the barrier of entry is lower than for the compiler, but it still exists. Of course, if you just want to optimize the implementation, then you can just submit a PR and we can accept it very, fairly easily.
Okay. You said that a language change, for instance, is discussed internally. Is that really internally, or is that internally but visible from outside?
At this time, the design process, most of the design process of Kotlin happens in a way which is not visible to the outside. So we have design meetings. They are just held like on site in the office of JetBrains, and we don't publish the minutes and we don't make them accessible in any way. But it may change at some point in the future.
How mature is Kotlin? If I write a Kotlin application now, will it work next week?
Yes, of course. We hope it will also work next year and next 2 years and so on.
It depends on how you write it.
Yeah, well, so we actually put a lot of attention to backwards compatibility, and especially backwards binary compatibility.
Okay.
So it's like the situation with Kotlin is very different with Scala from the one with Scala. So while Scala breaks its ABI basically with every release or almost every release, with Kotlin, we make sure that we never do that. So any library compiled with Kotlin, like 1.0 or even pre-release version of Kotlin, it will still work with Kotlin today. And as for source code compatibility, we make some minor breaking changes, but they are very constrained and do not affect a lot of code in practice.
So the approach is more of a Java approach. So I can still run 1.0 Java code on my JVM and it should theoretically work. And you're saying that that should apply to Kotlin as well?
Yes, and we also have, just like the Java compiler, we have this language level switch in the compiler. So you can say, even if you have a new version of the compiler, you can say that this code is Kotlin 1.1 and I want it to compile it according to the rules of Kotlin 1.1, and you can do that.
Okay, and then last section is what's the future of Kotlin? Where is Kotlin going? What's next for Kotlin?
The general direction that we are heading in is the support for multi-platform projects. So this is like the big strategic direction. And more specifically, it means like that Kotlin Native is going to get much more mature. So it's still, right now, it's still 1.0.6, I think, is the latest release number. 0.6 is the latest release number, and we are pushing hard to make this an actual release and fully commit to maintaining it further. As for the language itself, we have our plans. There are some features coming in 1.3, which we still haven't talked much about publicly, so I won't mention any specifics at this time. But yeah, we just want to essentially find the places which are not addressed well with the existing set of APIs in Kotlin and just fill them and close the gaps and make it more stable and
okay,
more easy to use.
You were talking about a new collections library for Kotlin as well.
Yeah, so this is one of the... So in terms of libraries, we are working on a lot of stuff. So we are working on a cross-platform input-output library. We're working on a serialization library, which is also cross-platform, so that you can automatically, like with very little effort, essentially convert Kotlin classes to JSON and send them over the wire, over HTTP, to a different part of your application. What else are we building? I think those are the most important things. And yeah, immutable collections are something that we are considering, but there is a prototype, but I don't know what's the status on when it's going to land as part of the Kotlin core.
Okay. No, thank you. Is there anything else that I should have asked you?
I think we've covered a lot of ground. I think that's the most important things that we are in the language. So, yeah.
How can listeners find out more about Kotlin?
Buy a book and read it.
Do you know of any good books?
We have a conference also this year in Amsterdam, so you can join the community.
Any links that you send me, I will happily put in the show notes. Thank you for joining us today, Dmitry and Svetlana. Where can people find out more information about you?
You mean information about Kotlin or information about us?
About you, if they want to watch videos.
I'm on Twitter as IntelliYole, and Svetlana is also on Twitter, but she doesn't tweet all that much.
Plenty of YouTube videos available.
There are lots of videos of our talks on YouTube, so you can just search for our names and you will find like many different presentations.
And come to KotlinConf. We'll be there.
Yeah, and come to KotlinConf in Amsterdam. This is October 3rd to 5th. I hope we will both be there, and there will definitely be lots and lots of interesting Kotlin talks from both JetBrains and the community.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thanks for inviting us.
This is Matthew Farwell for Software Engineering Radio. Thank you for listening.
Thank you.
Thanks for listening to SE Radio, an educational program brought to you by IEEE Software Magazine. For more about the podcast, including other episodes, visit our website at se-radio.net. To provide feedback, you can comment on each episode on the website or reach us on LinkedIn, Facebook, Twitter, or through our Slack channel at seradio.slack.com. You can also email us at team@se-radio.net. This and all other episodes of SE Radio is licensed under Creative Commons License 2.5. Thanks for listening.